You're watching Spotlight, a production of Culture in Maine, York's cultural showcase. I'm Carla Christopher, poet, publisher, and producer. Join me, along with editor, musical guru, and video extraordinaire Jay Schmuck, plus wild outdoorsman and videographer, along with technical extraordinaire Cliff Kern, and all of our friends, as we go behind the scenes and get into the underground of what's really going on in the arts and cultural amazing explorations that are happening in South Central Pennsylvania. You'll see everything from art to music to dance to theater, and you'll also get to meet the people who really make it happen. Find out how and why. Along with some great studio performances, some amazing on-the-street footage. You'll also get the real story. And that's what we're here to shine a spotlight on. Let's go. Our next guest is my new fave on the York scene. Amazing photographer, amazing human. And of course, because that's just the way that we do it in York, we're talking about super multi-talented. Like, I have to bring Emily G back again so that we can have the dance episode, so that we can have the art activist episode. I mean, we'll just, so just know that you will be seeing this person more than once. But today we will start by talking about the incredible photography, which is how we actually got to first artistically interact in person. Like, just wow. Just wow.
Thank you.
You know, photography is one of those, because I am that person with my cell phone that's like trying to catch like that picture of the pretty moon that's way up there that comes out looking like a little tiny dot on my phone. And I'm like, I just did something.
And there's nothing
wrong with
that. I just
did something with my
Android. That's good. That's good, though.
But then, I mean, it's enough that I can appreciate it. But I've gotten to see and look at enough photography over the years to recognize the eye. That ability to just capture a totally unconventional angle and lighting, and that will make me look at something I've seen a million times and feel like I've never seen it before. And I got to see that when looking through your photographs.
Oh, thank you.
Was here's images of people, here's images in this city, here's images of this park. This is something that I feel like I should know, but I don't. So
thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you.
What is the difference between taking a picture and taking an artistic photograph? What is it that you are doing differently than the people out there that are snapping photos and like, yeah, that's a good picture right there. Let me Facebook that.
Well, first of all, there's nothing wrong with just taking a picture. I mean, you know, we're making memories or maybe capturing memories in a
sure.
moment of time. And I think that that's something that has always drawn me into photography in general, even doing the photographic art. You're still capturing a moment of time, even if it's a posed
that's
moment.
True.
But I think one of the main differences is understanding that there is a very powerful tool at your disposal, and while having that eye is not always something that can be trained, some people
yeah.
are gifted with it. I think that learning how, not just like the technology in your hands and the composition that any artist would also use it with a painting or whatever, a sculpture, there's also the idea that you are also taking light. It's you have to be a light master, pretty much. You have to
yeah.
understand, like, we're in a studio right now with all these lights around us, and they're put there very specifically to help create a certain feel in here. They could turn it way down, they could turn it way up, and, you know, it would make a very different feel for what we're going for.
That's
and artistically
true.
It could be, you know, something just as good, just different. And I think often, you know, one of the things that I see is that, you know, I see a lot of people who are using their cameras more, and the more that they use it, the more practice they're getting, and maybe they don't know it, but they are building some artistic form maybe in there, they're taking their selfies up here, or they're taking their selfies down here. It's amazing.
That's true. Selfies are a science. You have to have the right angle, the right height. You walk into a high school
and they know all of the poses and everything to make themselves look a certain way. You know, that same part of the brain is, you know, maybe I'm not the same, like, it's not the same level as, like, trying to create, like, this amazing piece of, you know, amazing, huge photograph. But, you know, I think there is also the idea that there are people who think that it is just as easy, and that makes my job hard sometimes, you know, because I am a professional photographer. I'm not just an artist. I'm also working. That's my job. That's my business. I'm also a small business owner. And, you know, I have to convince people, it's not just that I have a big camera, I have to
right.
show the artwork as well.
So what kind of camera do you use specifically? I know this is, you know, to someone who is not a professional photographer, I am like, wow, it's a big camera.
Do you want to hold it? It's heavy.
But what is the, I mean, what exactly is the difference? Like, oh, good Lord. Like, how do you hold that through, like, a wedding or a photo session? I'm done with that.
You know, I did used to go to the gym. And I actually brought this along just because I had a shoot earlier today, and I have a few cameras. I've a couple. This is just a Canon 7D Mark II. It's a little bit lighter, not as powerful as some of the ones that I have worked with in the past, but... This was good for the job that I had today, and I have a nice long lens to show you. You know, kind of this. I wanted to show you the heft that sometimes it is. You know, this a lot. Yeah. It's a lot of equipment. It's basically carrying a computer around your neck sometimes.
Digital photography has so changed the game. It has completely changed photography. I know.
It has.
What is the point of having, like, what does it do to have this super long lens on there?
Well, so just to, I could talk for hours about, you know, all the technical stuff that goes into it, but this is called a DSLR, a digital single lens reflex. So when you have your camera and like your little point and shoot camera,
right?
What you see on the back of the screen, you know, it's just kind of, you know, it's a little different than this, because it's got, you know, just like a small image and, you know, megapixels. Everybody's all about the megapixels. It's,
yep.
But your sensor's like this big, maybe like this big on your phone. It's tiny. And so, you know, size of the megapixels doesn't actually matter. But what's necessary in this whole thing, which creates the very sharp images, as long as you focus it right.
Okay.
There's a lot of pieces of glass all along in here, and because this is a zoom lens, like, it can go in and out, and, you know, you've got all these pieces expanding and contracting, and they're curved in certain ways so that it doesn't distort, like, what you're seeing. So, you know, it's not just this little piece of glass right in there.
I never knew that. I always thought like the glass is like that piece on the end.
Nope,
there's a whole lot in there.
And that's why when you have like a big zoom lens like this, they can get pretty expensive, because like there's so many pieces and intricate pieces of technology in there. And then in here, I'll show you in here, you see a little mirror in there. And I don't know if
you can see a little, there's a little piece of glass in there.
So that is a mirror that is then going up, and there's a mirror that shows what's going on back here. So exactly what I'm seeing in here is what's going to go and hit a sensor, which is behind this mirror. It flips up, and the shutter and then that sensor is just a very intricate computer that then takes all the pieces of light and figures out what it is that it's seeing. So it's very much like an eye, actually. And I like to describe what I do to, you know, new photographers who want to get into taking control of their photography and wanting to understand what's going on. I think of it like an eye, because you have an iris, which is like your aperture. So when you see a lot of light come in, your iris gets really tiny because it's pinpointing the light.
Yeah.
And then it opens up when it's dark, which same exact thing that happens with your lens. And then the shutter is when you're blinking. And if you blink like real quick, like, you know, it takes in less light.
If
you keep your eyes nice and open, you stare at the light and you start getting those little dots in your eyes because you keep bringing in all that light. But it's a very simple way to explain what is going on in here. And I kind of like that connection. Like, it's like technological meets biological. And, you know, we're using the same functions in different ways to create something artistic, which it just means a lot to me, like that I have that connection. And I just think it's just so neat.
That is seriously cool. Now, you do both photography for yourself, mm-hmm. and creating art photographs, but then also art as, like you said, photography as a business, mm-hmm. and your art as a business.
Yes.
Doing portraits and special events and things like that.
Right.
How does that studio life work as an artist?
I am now finding more space for myself in the studio. So to kind of explain how my progression has gone over the past couple of years, the past few years, I've been a professional photographer for about 5 now. I used to work up at a studio in Camp Hill, and my husband, my now husband, is from York. So we decided to move back down there, our friends and family all down here. We just kept coming back down. So it was almost like, why avoid it? You know, we're Yorkians. And I have always been one to kind of just do things myself. And I love my old boss and my old crew up there, and I still work with them every so often. But I wanted to do it for me. And I heard a really good quote, small business owners, entrepreneurs will work 80 hours a week so they don't have to work 40 hours a week for someone else.
Mm.
And I love that quote. And I feel it. And there are days that I just am miserable. And there are days that I realized that I needed that to go through the miserable stuff to feel amazing. And so I started this studio, started my business last year and grew. And I didn't have a studio space yet. I was kind of working out of the apartment. And in February, right before my wedding, I'm a little crazy for planning my business right before my wedding. Yes. A lot of people and myself also did the facepalm. Okay. Moved into my studio, and I found it to be a really good place to bring in people to do just basic headshots, which, you know, it's the bread and butter is these portraits. And now that I have some time to focus on myself again, because a wedding is very much about, you know, huge, big event, and it takes up your whole life.
Sure.
And now I'm finding more time, and I'm pushing myself to do more art for me. So I have that sanctuary to go to. It's the same sanctuary that I use for my work. But now I'm getting excited because I'm using it more for me, and it's been really nice. But I don't need the studio, absolutely. Like it doesn't need to exist for me to do my work, because the whole world is out there. Like I've done so much, I can go to events. I don't have to bring the event to my studio. I can go out and be in the world and take these photographs and find places that I can set up as like a really neat studio in itself. Take somebody out for some fun portraits where we do something like, you know, really artistic with the tree branches or have like a really neat background. Like location can also be a good studio.
Wow. That is amazing. So now if people want to come and experience the studio, if they want to get in touch with you mm-hmm. for a photography shoot, mm-hmm. where and how can they find you?
They can either find me online. My website is egphotostudio.com. They can email me that way. They can see some of the artwork that I've done. Right now, and it's very seasonal, the job, because right now we just finished up a lot of the senior portraits. I'm sure I'll get more who want to get the leaves, but the ones for the yearbook, like that's all done, and the weddings are wrapping up. I have another wedding coming up, but you know, it's the wedding season is slowing down now.
Right.
So now it's family portraits, and I invite anybody who's interested in family portraits to give me a call. My number's also on my website, or email me, whatever's convenient. Set up a time, or if you just want to talk to me or come in, just see the place. I invite them to talk to me so I can open the doors for them. Sometimes I'm not there. I'm out and shooting. That's the problem with being a business of one at this time. But eventually, I can have it open all the time and have even more people come in. But I would love to see more people come in and see my work up on the walls, to feel like what they would experience space-wise if they wanted to have a studio session. We can talk about creative parts as far as props or setups or backdrops, and like that stuff's always fun to build. and I will be having a mini session probably in the weekend of the first weekend of November, I'm planning to have a mini session maybe over at Farquhar Park, because last year at that same time, the whole place was covered in these golden leaves and it was gorgeous. And I thought, oh my goodness, if I could just do 100 family portraits here, all of York would be happy with their golden leaves.
Yes.
It was gorgeous. So I love finding those little places that are within York that I can, you know, keep it here, because it's like what so many other people have said about York, is that this is the place to be, this is the place to grow, and there's so many nice little places that people can keep exploring and keep finding.
I love it. Well, you can feel the love of York, but there's no substitute for being in York and creating a memory that you get to take home and keep with you. And as someone who has gotten to see even more of the work than you've seen presented on the show today, I know that you will not be disappointed. So let this hometown girl share her love of this place and of the beauty of nature and her flawless artistic eye with you. Make sure to visit the website, make sure to visit the studio, and make sure to support one of York's most incredible professional photographers. I promise you, you're just going to feel so blessed by the experience. We are super excited that we had Emily join us today. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And we thank all of you at home for enjoying the segment. We'll be right back with even more.
Dave Sansoucie, ladies and gentlemen. Dave.
Should I use my radio? Can I do my radio?
That's actually a really good radio.
Bill Randall, 650 yard ass man, the actual line of veterans of his company, Basketball Johnny C.
Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. It ain't warm when she's away. Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. She's always gone too long. Anytime. Wonder this time where she's gone. I wonder if she's gone to stay. There ain't no sunshine where she's gone. This house just ain't no home when she goes away. Well, I know, I know, I know, I know. She goes away. There's only darkness every day. Oh, ain't no sunshine when she's gone. And my house just ain't no home when she goes away. My darling. I know, I know, I know, I know, I know, I know. I know.
Yeah, I really know.
Well, I know. Hey, I'm leaving your day alone, but my house just ain't no home. Well, she goes away. It's only darkness every day. She goes away. Every time she goes away. Every time she goes away.
Thank you.
Right.
Dave, a spiffy shirt.
I'm doing well. I'm doing very good.
Would you like to say a little something about the music going on today?
I think this is just amazing. It exceeds all expectations. I've known all of these people in one form or another. And to see them all playing together in this format is just, it's amazing.
A stranger. you seen the homeless daughter? Oh, standing there, standing there with broken wings. Well, I have seen all the flaming sword there over me. Love these people. Thank you.
Mike, God bless you.
We didn't know each other.
I just wish the best for you, my brother. And
exactly.
Keep going on. Keep on keeping on, brother.
Mike, I love you, man. You know, I walked in when I lost. I had a gig somewhere else. I wasn't sure where it was, and I walked in. You said to me, "Dude, you can play here Thursday night." So I was like, "Yay!" And you know, and it was really cool. That's where I met Chris Kostoff, and I got to play with Mo and a bunch of other people. And even when it was way down the list, as was my life, you said, "No." You support me so much. I love you.
I have a really exciting special guest with me today who is a whole new kind of creative for York. Now, Victoria is not just an artist. She is an artist with fabric. And she is not even your typical textile artist. She is a cultural educator, a chef, a language teacher, and at heart, a fashion designer who uses the textiles of her beautiful native country of Kenya to create palettes that splash across the human body and that create a cultural ambassadorship into the world, teaching York about the beautiful cultures that exist all around the world, specifically in her native continent of Africa, but also influenced by the beautiful, vibrant energies of the rest of the world, and specifically influenced by her life and loves, her family and children that are very grounded here in York, Pennsylvania, where else? So it is amazing to see all these influences come together in her clothing and in Gusa by Victoria, the fabulous gallery and fashion house that is in the WeCo neighborhood on the west side of York City. And I know you will love the clothes. I know you will love when you get the chance to experience the food, the language classes, the sewing classes, but mostly you will just love Victoria. So welcome to Culture in Maine, yeah. The corner of Culture in Maine where art and culture intersect in our fabulous art city here on WRCT, White Rose Community TV.
Yes.
We are super excited to have you here. Now, okay, so the center of your creative expression mm-hmm. is Gusa.
Yes.
What exactly is Gusa? Is it gift shop, fashion house, art gallery? Like, how would you describe this place you've created?
This place I've created is actually an eclectic space, an oasis, a cultural spot for all things that I grew up in. I'm originally from Kenya, I'm a native of Kenya. And I decided to open this. Originally was supposed to be a women's clothing store, but I felt that I could not just have it be a place to buy clothes and not talk about my experiences growing up in the continent of Africa, and specifically in Kenya. Mm. So it's a whole lot, it's a good mix of my creativity with the fabric and creating fashionable pieces for women and, you know, just people in general, and including everything that comes along with it, the foods that I grew up eating, the language that I spoke, the music that I listened to. And so I decided to bring everybody else along with me and just have it be a big party center
and
of humanity. Yeah.
Watching some of the events that have been being held at Gusa, mm-hmm. so you have the Swahili classes.
Yes.
And is Swahili your first language?
Yes, Swahili is my first language. And for most of us who grew up there in Kenya, Swahili, of course, is a national language, but we also have our mother tongue that we speak. So I want to say Swahili is my first language because I grew up in a town that had a lot of people traveling or moving into that area from different parts of the country. So my parents were originally from the central part of Kenya, the Kikuyu people. So we moved into Mombasa where there was just a whole group of different people. So Swahili was incorporated in our language, and it became our first language.
So Swahili is more of like a common language
when
all the different tribes are coming together in mm-hmm. places like Mombasa,
yeah.
where there's a lot of people coming from different areas,
yes.
that became the primary way to communicate.
Yes.
But then people also are speaking
Multiple other languages, because we have over 40 different dialects.
We are so lazy in America when it comes to our languages.
Yes, over 40 dialects, so you can imagine. Your neighbors, your teachers in school, the shopkeepers, and everybody around you speaking all these different languages, but we found a common language to be able to communicate and just get along with everybody else.
Well, that's a model that we can certainly use here. Now, I've also seen mm-hmm. you have sewing classes mm-hmm. at Gusa, and people can come in and learn just general sewing skills and how to use the machines, but they walk away with projects. You know,
yes.
this, come and make an amazing jumpsuit, come and make an amazing skirt, mm-hmm. come and make an amazing, you know, top or jacket.
Yeah.
There's all these wonderful choices. But now you also just did a culinary event.
Yes, I'm actually heading towards it. It's going to be held on the 29th of September. And that's going to be at the Central Market. The kitchen there allows you to be able to do something like that if you don't have, if your shop, for instance, I don't have a kitchen at my shop.
Sure.
And so I was able to rent space at that kitchen, the commercial kitchen there, and that's where I'm going to be showing people, walking them through the recipes and things of foods that I grew up on.
That's
going to be, I'm very, very excited about it because I decided to add other components to it. So I'll have traditional dances be part of the whole presentation. So as I'm talking to you and telling you the importance of what we ate and why we ate it and how it grew and where it grew, I'll also entertain you with the music that I grew up listening to while in the kitchen, because our parents and my grandmother and aunts and uncles would all, you know, just congregate in the kitchen and talk and sing and tell us stories of, you know, it's just wow. So I wanted that richness to come back and just be able to share with everybody.
So, I mean, when you speak about Kenya, mm-hmm. and I've even seen some of the pictures on social media and some of the beautiful Kenyan-inspired portraits that you've done. I love the series that you did with your girls.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like there's such a beautiful culture that's there, and you still have such a strong tie to it.
Mm-hmm.
Is it ever challenging to have to be part of two worlds? I mean, you have the wonderful culture that you came from, that you were born into, and then living here in a very different culture. How do you find a balance between being in two worlds at the same time?
There are times that I find it a little bit disturbing when somebody is not open to the different part of me that, you know, I bring forth. So, and I can only attribute that to folks that are really just grounded in what they've known and have been taught otherwise. And so I can't force someone to appreciate where I come from, or they have misconceptions about Africa in general. They've seen all these horror stories of starving kids and trouble everywhere.
Yes, the late night infomercial.
Yeah, let's shock everybody and tell them just how horrible the continent is. And for those people, you know, it's not a battle I'm wanting to readily go into. I will try to educate someone and show them a different side of the world through the beauty I grew up around. So, you know, in that aspect, I find it difficult or challenging. But then in the same token, I know I'm unique. Nobody else has gone through what I've gone through. And so I still stand in my truth. I try to impart that in my children and anybody else that's interested. So I just keep going, you know, for those that are willing to be part of the party that is life unfolding around us. You're more than welcome, you know. So that's how I find my balance.
I love that. And it is definitely a party at Gusa. I mean, there are jazz nights happening there.
Yes.
On third Thursdays. Mm-hmm. You have movie nights. Yes. You have when international artists are coming through. I've seen you have concerts in the gorgeous courtyard mm-hmm. you've built out back.
Yes.
So it's definitely a real center of culture that comes from all these different areas and, mm-hmm. and different forms of art. But, you know, at the heart is certainly the fashion.
Mm-hmm.
And it is a fusion mm-hmm. like your own life. There is this obvious inspiration from the colors and the movement, the energy, the beautiful fabrics of Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
But what makes it uniquely Victoria? What makes this your fashion line?
The difference between what someone else would make and what you find in my store is the fact that I am pulling and gathering information from everybody else around me that I grew up in Kenya. So what my grandmother wore, for example, what my mom wore, what my cousins and my aunts and everybody else around me, the matriarchs of our family,
sure.
really, really influence my work. So the workmanship is key. The story that I tell by, you know, getting an African print fabric and marrying it to a design or an inspiration that I find in clothes that an American woman would wear gives it that extra jazz to it, if you will. And so that is what makes my creations beautiful and unique.
I love it. And everything in the shop mm-hmm. is made there
yes.
in the shop.
It is handmade by yours truly, which sometimes Ooh. Is, I know, a few people that are in the industry, in the fashion industry, will look at what I'm doing and just say, that is a difficult thing to do because there's manufacturers that we could use, but I take pride in my work and I probably will end up having to use a manufacturer somewhere, but until then, I'm very, very, I'm heavily invested in my work, and I want to make sure that whatever is hanging on the racks for people to buy is something that you could take home and use and for a long time and pass it on, you know, to your young ones, you know, and so it wow. stays with you for a long time.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Now, yeah. when I look at the fabrics there, mm-hmm. there is a very elegant, very modern, very contemporary, mm-hmm. almost structural feel mm-hmm. to a lot of the shapes. And the workmanship is impeccable.
Mm-hmm.
One would think that that was what you had been doing for your entire life, but you actually came from a very different work background.
Yes, I did. And I've just recently parted ways with a profession that has really been, I want to say I have a love-hate relationship with it. And why is that? Is because I did not plan to even go that route to begin with. I was a single parent for a long time and I wanted to find, even though I had a love for what I do now, I wanted to be able to sustain my children. I have four children. And so I ended up finding my way into heavy equipment operations. So I spent 4 years as an apprentice through the local 542, it's the International Union of Operating Engineers.
That's
and
awesome.
Yeah, so 4 years I went through their program and they taught me how to use every equipment imaginable. So your any kind of excavator with any kind of attachment to it. So I've worked in demolition, I've worked in projects that would see me go to places like the Turnpike, for example. So I've built your highways, I've maintained your bridges, I've torn down buildings that did not, that needed to be torn down. What else have I done? I recently, my last assignment saw me in the farmlands of Pennsylvania, taking care of your natural gas pipelines. So we repaired those and maintained them, and made sure that you know, they didn't blow up because the pipes were too old.
Thank you, thank you for that.
But yeah, so it was interesting work, challenging. Challenging also in the fact that for a long time, I spent over a decade doing that work, and it paid me, you know, it rewarded me handsomely that I was able to take care of my children. But it was a constant struggle to go to work and be the only black female doing this kind of work, having to prove yourself over and over again, having to fight with the younger kids that coming in, and you know, people looking at you like it's time to pass on the baton to somebody else.
Right, like I just got here.
I know, right? And my kids still need shoes.
Right.
But yeah, so I am grateful that there was that opportunity to do that. But the other side of that is that it was a constant fight to go to work. And as much as I loved it, I had to come to a place that, you know, that I was okay to walk away from it and be happy for what it rewarded me with.
And has the cultural community, the artistic community, the shop and the retail community mm-hmm. been a better experience? How has that been entering into the world of owning your own shop, mm-hmm. boutique?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a whole different animal in itself that can be spirit breaking to those trying to maintain brick and mortar shops and do that work.
Especially with everything else going, with the trends of how our malls are no longer attracting people that want to walk to the shops. The difference between what I used to do and what I do now is the fact that this has been a passion of mine from as long as I can remember. And I'm not getting any younger. And I decided this is what I'm going to do from now on, you know, throughout the rest of my life, and make it work. So whatever it is I need to do to welcome people to the store is what is going to have to happen. So, and that is why it's more than just a women's clothing store. It's a place where you come to do listen to jazz music, like, as you stated before. As a matter of fact, tomorrow is when our third Thursday jazz session is going to be happening. So, and so we do that. We do open mic nights. We do the sewing classes, and then recently with the addition of the culinary parts of it, is what I'm trying to do to just, you know, bring people out to the store.
So if people want to mm-hmm. find you, find your amazing events, and get involved, they want to come and support Gusa. They want to shop and see some of these beautiful clothes or mm-hmm. attend these events. How can they do that? How can they connect with the shop?
We have a Facebook page dedicated to the business, so Gusa by Victoria. As a matter of fact, Gusa is a Swahili term for touch, so that's what it means, touch by Victoria. Yeah, so that's how you would find us on our dedicated page on Facebook, Gusa by Victoria. We also have a website, and that website carries my name only because there's so much to me, and you go through Victoria Kageni. That's VictoriaKageni.com is where you find everything, the shop and everything else that I do. Because we creative people are never quite finished, are we? There
never.
Is always something brewing.
Well, there will always, always be something exciting happening at Gusa. And I tell you, it has become one of my very favorite places to visit. It is on West Philadelphia Street in the 200 block.
Yes.
It is just an amazing oasis. There is a gallery there that features the work of local artists. Mm-hmm. There is beautiful international goods that you can purchase. oils and scents. There's even a great sock line.
Yes.
The men's sock line is just, true. Those are sexy socks.
They are.
And the fashion is remarkable. Mm-hmm. And the events are not to be missed. So please go check out that Facebook page and go see the events there. Browse the gallery, the store. Enjoy the clothes. Find the food events and taste the food, the music, the dancing. But just know that we are lucky enough that Kenya has come to York and has made it that much richer, more beautiful, and more vibrant. And you have the chance to be a part of it. Thank you, Victoria.
Thank you
for bringing that to York.
Oh, you're welcome. And I look forward to meeting all your friends and people that haven't been to the store. There's a lot that is yet to come.
Ooh,
yes.
That's exciting.
What's up, people? You know, we said it like that and we said it like this. You know, it's Mike Axe that we really miss. We wish he'd be back at the captain service some drinks. In fact, he's in the hospital, really stinks. We gotta get him back with us, get him back healthy. Yo, I can't think of a word but smelty. And I don't think I'll give it to Jay right now because Jay is the man and he's gonna go pow.
Hey, did you guys bring on your costumes tonight?
Oh, love, love, love.
This is Sean Beck.
All love, that's all I got.
This is DJ Extraordinaire, part of Compound,
right?
Compound. DJ Cash.
Brass Monkeys.
Brass Monkeys.
And A.D. Chandler's side piece.
Monkeys! Ooh! Hey! Woo! Woo! Hey, how you feeling?
This dude organized this event. He won't take credit.
With help from everybody involved.
Yeah.
Betsy Eister, Dom Shortino, social
Dom,
media.
Without this guy, it wouldn't even be possible.
No, not true.
Seriously.
Not true.
That sounded pretty damn good. That sounded pretty damn good.
I love the cab. I grew up in the cab. I can remember going there as a child. And it was the greatest experience ever. And I love it. I love Mike. Mike has given more than anybody ever has in this town to music, in smaller increments. Short has been big donations, you know, here and there with people that have the big donations, but Mike gives out of his own pocket for what he cares for, and it is a staple. The first cap is necessary for us to have in this town, so that we have somewhere where you're gonna go see music you're never gonna see anywhere in this town, and it's free.
The cap is the best place to go in New York, and it should never go away.
Oh. What up, cap? Because you can't, you won't, and don't stop. Because you can't, you won't, and don't stop. Yeah, you won't, and you don't stop. Spike D, come and rock the show.
I got a brand new dude, you guaranteed like you. I'm on like Dr. John, yeah, Mr. Sue. So I'm a newlywed. Divorcee, and everything I do is funky like Lee Dorsey.
What is the thing in the battle of 1, 2, 3? If you wanna do the line, then come see me. I got that step on fire with a unique rhyming. Keep it on and on, never quit coming. Strictly handheld is a style to go. Never rock the mic with the pantyhose. Strap on my head goggles and I'm ready to go. Cause at the boards is the man they call a Fornio.
Well, I pull up to the function and you know I coach it. To all my body people that be on my phone. I got more action than my man John. It's like I was rocking the room.
Because you can't,
you won't,
and don't stop. You know you can't,
you won't,
and don't stop. You know you can't,
you won't,
and don't stop. Dead rock, come and rock the short shot. Get a profane on your ass and bust your eardrum. Instead of everybody come up, shit the gizm. Ready like Becky when I get my spit kit. Hold the microphone like I'm correct. Time like a clock when I rock the hip hop. Top notch is the stock of my soul pop. I got the rounds and I got great hair. And that's a lot.
I got a hole in my head and there's no one to fix it. Gotta straighten my thoughts, I'm thinking too much shit. That everyone just takes it, takes, 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 takes. I gotta step back, I gotta contemplate.
I'm likely very, very bored. Right the microphone and then I'm bored. I'm like bored. Holy, I'm a chief wizard. I'm a great soldier, listen. Come on, get those asses out of their seats,
man. Ah, yes indeed, it's fun time.
Well, you say I'm 20-something and I shouldn't be slacking. Well, I'm working harder than ever, and you can call a Mac. And someone's supposed to visit by my couch and watching the TV. Still using the wax, I'm not losing the CD.
Well, I'm that kid in the corner. All fucked up and I want to talk
order.
Your piece of the power that's not great. Think of a piece of my sound. I keep my underwear off with a piece of elastic. Use a bullshit mic that's made out of plastic. Send my rhymes out cause it feels alright. We're gonna rock all night cause musicians love Mike.
Because you can,
you won't,
don't stop. You won't,
and you don't stop.
Born in a rock in a sure shot. Musicians love Mike. You guys love Mike. This is for Mike.
And I've played there 3 times, and it always astounded me that there's never a cover in this little living room, and yet you always get paid. You always walk out paid. There's a man that respects the craft.
Mike, I love you, man. I love you. Thank you. Thank you for all you've done for me personally, and thank you for all you've done for every musician in this town and not in this town.
I love Mike. So we are outside the Capitol Theater in New York, beautiful historic Capitol Theater. And if you just walk down that way, two or three blocks, you're gonna hit First Capital Dispensing Company. And that's where all the magic happens. That's where all the music happens. Mike Axe just started bringing musicians in and it's been amazing. So if you're ever here, downtown York, the historic Capitol Theater, and you see a nice show here, a bunch of shows listed, and then you get out and you walk down that way, you're gonna go to the Cap, and like Mike Kolash said earlier, you know, you're gonna get a great burger there. I've had the burgers at the Cap, they're very good. Several different drafts. Excellent place to hang out. As Betsy said, it's like your living room. It's like somebody's living room. You hang in there, hear good music, have a good burger.
On another amazing episode of Spotlight, a production of Culture in Maine, York's Cultural Showcase. We want to hear your ideas, and we want you to be a part of the show. Whether you're an artist or a fan, send us an email to cultureinmaine@gmail.com. Check us out on the web at wrct.tv, or make sure to find all of our past episodes on YouTube at youtube.com/WhiteRoseCommunityTV. Thanks again for joining us, and have a great week. We'll see you soon, right here on the corner of Culture in Maine. Now you know